Good evening. I'm Brian King, and I'm a member of Seattle Friends of Fission. We want to welcome you to this discussion tonight titled Making the Case for Nuclear Power in the 21st Century. Friends of Fission believes that tonight's panel will well serve the main goal of our group, which is public education on nuclear power. I'm a lifelong environmentalist, and for the last 10 years, I've been focusing almost entirely on the issues of global warming and climate change. And probably like a lot of people here tonight, I was finding it more and more gloomy the more I studied it, until I ran across the work of a man named James Hansen, who's often referred to as the godfather of global warming. I was reading his book, Storms of My Grandchildren, and in that book, he finally got to the part, well, what should we do about it? And his suggestion was we need to build lots of new nuclear power. Well, this kind of startled me. You know, I've been mildly anti-nuclear most of my life, but I got interested and really studied it. Hansen's explanation of the many advantages of nuclear power gave me a real sense of hope. I know that our panel tonight wants to share that same sense of hope with all of you who have come for tonight's panel. Our moderator will be Scott Montgomery. Scott teaches at the Jackson School at University of Washington. He is also a prolific writer who, with 15 books to his credit. His latest due out this fall is titled, Seeing the Light, Making the Case for Nuclear Power in the 21st Century. Seeing the Light is co-authored by Thomas Graham Jr. Please join me in a warm round of applause for Scott Montgomery.
Thank you very much. I enjoy your applause before I deserve it. Tonight I'm going to give you a little bit of an introduction to the subjects we'll be discussing. And then our panel over here will introduce themselves also. We'll talk about our past and how we came to be up here on this stage and to be speaking to you at a particularly important historic time. I have to say I'm very, very pleased, very happy to see so many people here. Seattle's a pretty well-educated town, and though it has a reputation for being excessively liberal, it's not. It has a lot of open minds about a lot of things. And we are here really to give you information more than opinions. I'm sorry to say that we will not be presenting any alternative facts or alternative truths. I know that some of those are probably very close to your heart at this point. You've all gotten rather used to them. However, tonight we have reason and motive to be more loyal to the actual truth. So let me start just by saying something that you all know, and that is that our world is changing. It's changing in the oceans, in the atmosphere, in the hydrosphere, water in all forms, and of course in the biosphere, which includes us. It's changing in ways that may be productive in some areas, but are clearly destructive in others and worrisome. And it's not coming in the future, it is here now. There is enough information, and the University of Washington is a place where people do a great deal of research and discussion about this. We're very blessed at the UW to have some very top-notch climate scientists in terms of their world reputation. It is happening now, and we are able to actually extend backwards some of the projections and the patterns that we see that have come about into the past, as far as things such as Hurricane Sandy and the cyclone Nargis that killed so many people in the Irrawaddy Delta in Myanmar. This is very serious, and for those of us that have children, we are looking at climate change when we look at them. And so it is something that will be with us for quite a while now, but it is also something whose final appearance is within our control. And that is the real reason why we are up here, not because we love a certain form of technology, but because we are worried about the future and want to do something serious about it. I don't make any money from the nuclear industry. I lecture, and as you may know, lecturers don't really make enough money to buy large houses in Capitol Hill or anything like that. Or anywhere, really, for that matter. But never mind. Maybe one of my my monitors out there. So the only benefit for being here for me is to tell you things that I know, that I've learned over time. Things that are, I think, serious but very important for you to know and that I'd like to share with you. Okay, now, the reason our world is changing is complex, but it has an awful lot to do with the types of fuels that we have been using in the past two centuries, and the types of fuels that are now still being used to a very large degree around the world, both in developed states, but even more in developing and emerging economies. It's not just China or India, it's many countries in the developing world that feel that fossil fuels are the way to modernize, industrialize, motorize, electrify their societies. And which choices they are making now are the choices that they will have to be with, that they will be invested in terms of their capital stock, for decades and decades. It is very important that they make the right choices. And so that's another reason why we are up here, to talk about what we consider to be a very important alternative. Now, this panel is going to talk about nuclear power, obviously. It's not an important source, it's an essential source. It is not the only essential source. I want to make that very, very clear. We are not looking at a nuclear irrealis kind of world. That world is fantasy anyway. It was a fantasy of the past. It is not a fantasy of the present. We need diversity of sources. Every source has its limitations. And through history, the number of sources of energy that we have used, particularly electricity, has increased, not decreased. From the time that we used wood, we moved on to coal, and then to oil, natural gas, nuclear, hydro, and the renewables, solar, wind, geothermal, and hopefully in the future, tidal and wave energy sources as well. So our whole path, historically speaking, has been to diversify energy sources, and that's really a good thing, because each one of them has a limitation that another one can fill. So some are highly polluting, we need alternatives to those. Some only work certain portions, certain seasons, certain areas. They're very connected with weather. There are others that work full time, all the time, 24/7. We need all of these together. And that is another message that I would definitely like to convey to you, and that my associates here will be talking about a little bit as well. Now, to dismantle the fossil fuel system that we have. Fossil fuels run the world. They are not finished running the world. Most energy experts today predict that fossil fuels will be running 70% of the world in 2040. Now, I should say that's a forecast, not a prediction, right? It was Yogi Berra who said it's really tough to make predictions, especially about the future. And so forecasts change, and our hope is to change them in a significant way. The total fossil fuel system that exists in the world today is worth about $25 to $30 trillion. This is not a small system. It is penetrative in many, many societies. It reaches into every aspect of our lives, whether we own a car or not. It is going to take time and effort and courage, never mind political will, it'll take courage to reduce this, dismantle it over time, and replace it. But we are not going to turn this system around in a decade or two or even three, but we can do a lot. And we could do a lot with the technology that exists, technology that is proven in the past. But we cannot do this with theory or with scenarios that appear as if they are fantasy right now. Things that don't exist. Okay? So we're going to be talking about something that does exist. One of the things that I'd like to mention is that the opposite and also a similarity to nuclear is probably the most dangerous fuel that we have used, but it is also the fuel that we have built the modern world on, and that is coal. Now, coal is 70% of all fossil fuel energy in terms of BTUs or energy content. It is enormously abundant, and the United States has the most. So the pull to use it is huge, enormous. It's also the most, and I use this term loosely because it's nature, democratically distributed fuel around the country. More countries have this than have gas or oil or any other resource. Now, we did not know until very recently how really dangerous coal is. It took research on air pollution in other countries, particularly China, but also India and Indonesia and a number of other countries that use coal, Eastern Europe to a large degree, before we came to the conclusion that coal is not only bad for the climate and for the waters, but it actually produces a great deal of poisons in our air and is actually killing somewhere between 2 and 3 million people prematurely a year now. And that includes 7,000 to 9,000 people in the United States. That is decreasing because our coal use is decreasing, but it is not going away. Coal is our friend, historically, perhaps, but it is also our enemy if we are worried about poisoning the earth that we live on. So alternatives to coal that can do the job of coal and can do it better are very, very important. During the time that we have discovered what coal is like, we have also discovered other things. It's taken about 3 decades of experience with coal, just about the time that has elapsed since an accident happened in a small town in what is today Ukraine. We've had 3 decades to study what happened at Chernobyl. 3 decades with thousands of scientists studying the impacts of that. Not making claims about it, but going, taking samples, looking at the environment, all the plant life, the animal life, and especially the people. 3 decades is a lot of time. And we have an enormous amount of information. This information was gathered by eight different organizations, mostly connected with the United Nations. They have no agenda in terms of nuclear power, even with nuclear weapons. They have no agenda. They are there to study it. So this is a very large scientific process that has been going on for quite a while, and a major publication was put out in 2006. The 30th anniversary. And it is from that we have gathered a great deal of information. Okay, and some of that we will be talking about tonight. All right. But first, let's pose just a few questions before I introduce the panel. What kinds of questions come up about nuclear power? I'm sure you have a lot, and I have a lot still, even though I've been studying it now for a decade and a half. I'm a geoscientist. I worked in the energy industry for about 2 decades. I taught at the university for 14 years. I teach courses in energy. I give lectures all around the country. I do a lot of writing about this. I take my knowledge very seriously. And that does not mean that I use one or two sources and I find that that's okay. I've talked to many, many, many people around the country. I also have a side business as a consultant in scientific communication. I had the good fortune to be able to lead a workshop at the Centers for Disease Control and talk to a lot of radiologists and health physicists there about the radiation situation. So I'm not a naive anymore. I was a anti-nuclearist, pretty active in the 1970s when I was young. And as Brian says, I was sort of a middle road anti-nuclear until I began to read a great deal about it. And that has really changed my view in a very serious way. As a scientist, knowledge matters, and knowledge can change your opinions if you keep the doors open. Okay, so in terms of questions, what makes nuclear power attractive? Why do engineers and scientists keep coming back to it? We thought it was going to go away. We haven't built a new reactor in the United States for 30 years. We're building several now. But we thought it was gone. But engineers and scientists, and not old ones, young ones, come back to it. What attracts them to it? That's a good question. And you'll hear some of the answers to that. Another question, what are some of the human stories? The stories for people who live near a reactor. It's very interesting. It's very, very interesting that people who live near a reactor favor nuclear power more than people who don't. That's just a fact, and it's been polled again and again and again. What are some of the human stories about this? We'll hear some of those tonight too, because the human dimension is very, very crucial. What about the waste? We're going to talk about the waste, of course. This is the land of Hanford. We are not going to let that subject go by the by. Okay? Very serious for the United States, serious for a lot of other countries as well. But you'll hear about that from someone who actually has worked on Yucca Mountain. We want to give you good sources. And perhaps, in a way, some of the more basic questions. Where is nuclear technology today? It has not stood still. In the same period of time that wind and solar have progressed enormously, nuclear technology has moved ahead too. And that is what is attracting. That is one of the things that are attracting young nuclear scientists and engineers, and we'll hear about that also. Cost, said to be the Achilles heel of nuclear power. And yet, there are countries all over the world who want it. How are they going to get it? If it's so expensive, why does Kenya want it? Why does Ghana want it? Why does Myanmar want it? And how can they get it? How is it that South Korea is able to build four reactors in the Persian Gulf for the United Arab Emirates and do it on time and on budget? The first of those reactors, and they are big reactors, is going to be starting up in just a few months. How are they able to do that? Do they have magic? Something in the air? No. Okay. Another question we will talk about. And then just the last thing that I want to mention to you. Jim Hansen, as Brian told us, is a very well-known climate scientist, but he is not the only climate scientist that favors nuclear power. And nuclear power, not again above everything, but as a necessary component of a cleaner, non-carbon future. But he's not the only one. Stephen Moore, one of the founders of Greenpeace, is pro-nuclear. Now, of course, they never admit that he had anything to do with him. He is an apostate. But they have signed an agreement with him that they would let him survive. They're very nasty to him on their website, by the way. James Lovelock. Anybody know who James Lovelock is?
Gaia.
Yes, the Gaia. And that idea is that the Earth is one giant organism. The rocks, the trees, the ocean, the air, us, little particles that we are. Everything is part of one organic whole, and he is very pro-nuclear. And the reason is that he's very serious about Gaia and her future. And finally, the IPCC, which talks about the necessity for nuclear power, and one gentleman I want to mention to you, a gentleman who used to be a reporter on energy for the New York Times for 30 years. Matt Wald wrote among the best articles on the energy situation in the United States. He was the one that you could go to and get an unbiased view, whether it was oil or gas, whether it was wind or nuclear or coal. He left the New York Times not long ago. Where did he go? He works for the Nuclear Energy Institute in the United States. Why? For the same reason that we are up here. He sees nuclear as an absolute necessity for the future. So much so that he has taken an activist position now. This is no ordinary person. So are all these people wrong? Can they all be wrong? I can be wrong, I know that. My wife will tell you that. But these other people have fought through energy matters very deeply and for a long time and in many different circumstances and looking around the world as a whole and looking into the future. So that on its own should give us enough of a reason to maybe keep our minds open about things. Okay, and now I'd like to introduce the panel to you. Does anybody? Once they wake up, I will introduce them to you.
I'm Kristen Zace. I'm the co-founder of Mothers for Nuclear.
I'm Kristen Zace. I'm the co-founder of Mothers for Nuclear. I'm a civil engineer by training, and my day job is working at Diablo Canyon Nuclear Power Plant on the central coast of California. Happy to be with you here tonight. Oh, okay, I guess I'm gonna say a little bit more about myself now. So on the left, that is my grandma and my grandpa on their third date. She was a Husky, so I'm happy to be here in the land of my grandparents. Oh, thank you. And on the right, that's my father and me. I'm the oldest of four children, and my parents lived on the central coast of California when I was born. They were hippies, as you can tell, he played the guitar. He surfed a lot. He didn't really want to have a full-time job. They called it their early retirement. And by the time, I think, like the third or fourth child came around, they realized that they had to support us, fortunately. So we moved to Northern California into a little town in the foothills of the Sierra Nevada, and it was great. I spent a lot of time outdoors. We always had enough resources, but we never had the excess that I think a lot of us enjoy today. For example, it was a two-bedroom house, and my siblings and I all shared one room, two bunk beds, and when I got a little older, I was like, I don't want to share a room with my six-year-old brother anymore. So I went and slept outside and stayed there, you know, almost through the whole winter, and then it got really cold. Anyway, this was the backdrop of my life, spending time outdoors. I did a lot of backpacking and hiking and exploring, and while doing that, I gained an appreciation for our natural environment. My uncle, who has a PhD in geology, and I'm surrounded by geologists here, I feel really happy about that. He took me to Yosemite after I was finishing a year-long research project on John Muir. And we took rubbings of glacial striations, and I learned about his activism and his work trying to preserve our beautiful natural spaces in this country. When I went to college, when I went to college, I chose civil engineering because I saw pictures of advertisements for what do you want to be when you grow up, and civil engineers were outside. And so I thought, okay, that's what I want to be. And fortunately, it worked out. I enjoy civil engineering, but that was the whole reason behind it. And I took a job, actually, I'm not going to tell you about my job yet. I'm going to say, in college, I identified with all my friends were environmentalists and environmental volunteers and outdoor activities enthusiast, and I didn't know anything about nuclear power, really. But I was near Diablo Canyon when I went to school. I went to Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, and so it was just a thing that we were anti-nuclear. And I thought, okay, well, these are my friends, and I'm just going to be anti-nuclear too. So that's what happened. And then I took a public speaking class. I gave one speech, and I got a great grade, and I was feeling like super good about myself. And then the next speech was supposed to be examining a controversial topic, and so I chose nuclear power, and I thought I was just going to slam nuclear power. So I did the research, I did a little more research, and I came out with a speech that was actually a little bit pro-nuclear. I examined the pros and cons of our different available energy sources, and I gave that talk. And my professor, I was a super high achiever in college, and he gave me a C, and I was crushed. And so I went to him afterwards and said, what did I do wrong? What can I do better? And he said, well, your speech was great. I just don't agree with you on nuclear power. And so then I saw just how polarized the topic is, and that's part of why I'm here with you guys tonight. It shouldn't be a polarized conversation. We need to stay in dialogue about important energy issues. So here I am at my job at Diablo Canyon. I did get to be outdoors. I've rappelled off the containment structures, inspecting the concrete. It's in pristine condition. I've scuba dived off the coast. That's me. There's a lot of beautiful marine life out there, and I've just been privileged to see it up close and personal. And now I'm trying to teach my children the same values that I grew up with, and getting them outdoors. I feel that when you experience nature, you develop a connection with it that will serve you a lot better than learning about things in a textbook, and it certainly has for me. And anyway, I'm going to pass it on to Jim now. So thank you very much for the opportunity to be here.
So I'll just be brief here. So my name is Nick Duran. I'm a nuclear engineer specializing in reactor physics. I work at our local advanced nuclear reactor design company. It's called TerraPower. It's over in Bellevue. Nice to have some fans. Thanks for coming. I've always been, everyone knew I was going to be an engineer when I was a kid. The quick story there is my dad brought home a broken radio when I was like 6, and I took it apart and wiggled everything around and put it back together, and it worked! Of course, I didn't check to see if it worked beforehand, but that gave me the confidence to think I was really good at this kind of thing, and that sort of propelled me along, at least to engineering school. I was interested in energy from when I was about 17. It just really seemed like one of those interesting problems that the world is facing, and maybe there's some room for me to make some kind of contribution on. And it seemed like a pretty big deal. So when I was at engineering school, I went in and asked a peer advisor what to major in. And I said, I'm interested in energy. And she said, well, have you heard of our nuclear engineering department? And of course, I said, no. What? But she recommended I take the class, an introductory class, which satisfied some requirement anyway. So I took it, and I was kind of amazed at what I learned. The professor there, Kim Kerfoot, just gave this amazing overview of the energy source and the challenges and the problems and the ways people are working on different challenges. And she brought in a bunch of different speakers on some of the really hot topics. And it was just amazing. And I knew that this is what I want to do. So that's what I did. Stuck with nuclear engineering for a while and got into advanced fission as a research topic, because I thought that was really something that's kind of futuristic, but also within the realm of possibility. Of course, all my colleagues said, well, there's no advanced reactors being built. Where will you get a job? And I said, I don't know. But just as I got basically enough skills to be useful to anyone, this company, TerraPower, came along. And they were looking for people who had skills designing advanced reactors, which happened to be what I was working on. So they called my research group and said, hey, send us a guy. So I came out, and basically I never left. And so, and that company, by the way, was founded by Bill Gates and Nathan Myhrvold, who are trying to find energy sources that will solve a lot of the major challenges of world scale, responsible, sustainable, clean energy. And that's exactly what I had gotten into it for. So it was really kind of a lot of luck there that that happened. So that's what I'm doing up here. And I also had, along the way, my friends and I realized that a lot of people are hesitant to support nuclear power. And we were, for some reason, we were interviewing people on the street, and we said, what do you think about nuclear power? And one lady framed it so well. She said, you know, I don't really like it, but honestly, I don't know hardly anything about it. And I think, I thought that just like covered how a lot of people really feel about it. So we made a webpage. So we have a sort of a volunteer run webpage in our spare time called whatisnuclear.com. And I do some outreach through that. It's just a nuclear public education webpage. If you Bing, nuclear waste, I think it's one of the top hits, especially if you Google it. Anyway. Okay, so that's me.
I'm kind of embarrassed because I have all this junk up there, sorry. So I actually started as a planetary scientist at NASA and working on the origin of life, especially seeding anaerobic algae on Venus. Interesting subject. That was before we found out there was sulfuric acid rains and kind of killed that. But, it's a harsh environment. But I actually was coordinator of shuttle operations over the poles in 1986, right before the Challenger blew up. And all of us youngins at that time had to find another job. And so we actually, many of us went into nuclear. It's kind of a bizarre thing, but it fit because nuclear's kind of weird, NASA's kind of weird. So I kind of took off from there, especially nuclear waste, because I'm the nuclear waste expert, and found out it's not at all what you think. I mean, actually, everyone in here probably has no idea what nuclear waste is, what the really issues are, what the history is. It's fascinating, and if we have time to go into it, we will. But just like what's going on at Hanford, you really have no idea what's going on. It's kind of strange, of course, but not what you think. So again, pretty much most of the issues that everyone worries about is not very well discussed in public and dialogue or anything else. And I mean, I love watching, you know, Rachel Maddow, and whenever she has a nuclear person on, it's never a scientist. I mean, almost nuclear, because there's not many nuclear scientists. They have to, right away, there's hardly any of us. And so it's kind of hard to get us around. So starting on that subject, in Scott mentioned the alternative fact world we seem to be in, I kind of wanted to just set the stage. Okay, so what's real, what's going on? Because you really can't talk about these issues without talking about the bigger picture. So let me just kind of jump in here. I love these NASA nighttime shots because I used to take them. So one thing you can tell is right away is who has energy and who doesn't. And that's what the fighting's about, that's what it's always been about. It's always a resource thing with humans fighting each other. But you can tell, and this is actually, it's kind of a spectrographic picture as well. So the brighter the light, the more energy that area is producing. So it's kind of neat. You can see lots of dark areas. Some of them don't have many people in them. Some of them have a lot of people in them. So again, we have the developed world that has all this, tons of energy, mainly, you know, United States, Europe, and China is coming on. Japan has a lot. And so right now we generate 20 trillion kilowatt hours of electricity a year. That's a big number. It's a good round number too, so you can remember it. We are moving to 30. By 2040, we'll be producing 30 trillion kilowatt hours. So whenever anyone talks about alternative energy, they always use the static number that we're at now and say, wait a second, the number's growing. So you have to not just replace coal and oil, but you have to replace more than that because the pie is actually growing. And that's what people kind of forget. And the reason that it's growing is because the only thing that's ever tracked with quality of life in human history has been access to energy. It doesn't matter whether you're a 17th century nobleman that was getting the equivalent of 3,000 kilowatt hours a year off the backs of slaves, indentured servants, a few horses and a few oxen. It's a great calculation for students, by the way. Or everyone in this room who's getting about 10,000 kilowatt hours a year off the backs of in this state, hydro, a little nuclear, a little everything else. It doesn't matter. You need about 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year to have what we consider a good life, to be in the middle class. And it doesn't matter where you are. You need about 3,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. That's why that the amount of energy is growing. Because this is the weird ethical thing. It's sort of like, well, you can't deny people energy because that's how you have a good quality of life. But you can't just give it to them with coal because you're going to have other effects. So this is not a simple problem. You need to give people energy because it's the ethical thing to do, but you need to give them energy that doesn't destroy the world. So that's the problem. So it's hard to talk about energy without talking about climate change. And this is the history of climate change. Climate change isn't a new thing. It's been around for the last 4 billion years. But this is a graph that looks at climate change for the last 540 million years since fossils first developed. So it's kind of a weird to fit 500 million years on a graph. We kind of squeeze it. So this part is thousands of years. This is millions of years. This is tens of millions, and this is hundreds of millions. Okay. So again, first thing, right off the bat, you see, the last 10 million years, we have been in a very cold period, okay? Unusually cold, as far as the Earth is concerned. The Earth is usually warmer, there's usually more CO2 in the atmosphere. It doesn't matter, actually, what the absolute temperature is or what the absolute amount of CO2 in the atmosphere is. It's all about the rate of change. When things change quickly, the biota doesn't like it. I mean, I don't like change, my cats don't like change. No one likes change, okay? And when you change too quickly, things die. That's all there is to it. It's called extinction in technical terms. But whenever you get these huge swings in temperature, it's followed by a huge extinction event. During the Devonian, we lost 93% of life on Earth. That's actually a big number. Now, life isn't gonna extinct. I mean, it's not gonna, you know, the Earth is not going to become lifeless, but a lot of things we like will die. That's just the way it is. And the funny thing here is that the rate of change, again, this is only 150 years, so it's not like 100 million years. So this is actually a very fast change. We are changing the temperature and the CO2 concentrations fast. Okay, that's it. It doesn't matter what the absolute number is. It doesn't really matter. It's simply the rate of change. So when people talk about, oh, it's no problem, there's always, you know, CO2 was higher in the past. It's higher in the past. Who cares? If it changes quickly and the temperature changes quickly, things go extinct. And that's just the bottom line. So this is kind of interesting. We know these are called Milankovitch cycles and all that kind of thing. So we understand climate change better than you might think. Okay. I'd love to talk about climate change more and more, but we'll just get to the urgency issue. And the urgency issue is this. If we want to keep the warming trend to only 2 degrees C, which is about 3.5 degrees Fahrenheit, if we want to keep it to just that, there's no way we're going to go back. There's no way we're going to keep it the temperature it was 50 years ago. But to keep it to only 2 degrees C, this is what we have to do. Okay, so again, we have to decrease the overall global emissions by some amount. And in 2011, had we started decreasing emissions, we only had to decrease them about 4% a year, right? Then get down to very low levels, and it didn't have to be zero, by about 2050, and that would actually keep global temperatures reasonable. But we blew that one, okay. So 2015 comes along, and now we have to decrease 5% a year, which is actually fairly significant, and costly. So we have to, you know, then we'd have to actually go to almost zero, okay. We blew that one. So now 2020 is coming up. Okay, we're still increasing emissions. And so by 2020, we now have to start decreasing 9% a year. And this is when people talk about the tipping point. This is the tipping point. You kind of get to a point where you're vertical, and you're done. Okay, it's too late. So this is why the urgency, why everyone talks about the urgency. And that's actually quite serious. This is not a trivial thing to do. Globally. Now, the United States is actually in pretty good shape. We are at a 25-year low in terms of U.S. emissions because gas has replaced coal. It has nothing to do with anything else. Gas has been replacing coal. Okay, cheap gas. We got lots of cheap gas. We have lots of cheap coal, too. We have lots of cheap oil. So essentially, we've been doing well only because gas has been replacing coal. And gas is much better than coal. I mean, if you need an evil, coal is it. That's great. It kills people, destroys the environment, blah, blah, blah. But if you need an evil. It's hard to talk about things as evil, though, because coal lifted 2 billion people up out of abject poverty. It's kind of hard to say, well, it's evil. Yeah, that's okay. We can do better, and we can do better without coal. But it's not easy, and it's not simple. So, with that, just shout it out. What's the fastest growing energy source in the world? Just shout it out.
Solar.
Right, higher. Absolute number.
Coal.
Yeah, bummer, coal. Okay, so, and that's a problem. And that's not in the U.S. In the U.S. it's not going on. This is going on in essentially Asia, of sub-Saharan Africa, and in Indonesia. So, because those people need energy. And it turns out, it's not that coal is cheaper or anything. It's simply easier to emplace if you have no infrastructure to speak of. If you're a poor country, you have no infrastructure, no pipelines, no grid, nothing. It's easy to install coal. That's it. And so, of course, if you have no infrastructure, you're going to install coal. That's it. I mean, you're not going to start building pipelines. Pipelines are very expensive for gas. We have a lot. But the Sudan doesn't. So this is, you know, this is nothing to do with science or anything else. It has to do with ease of implementation. So coal is it. It's the easiest thing to do. And all COP21 was about, all the climate change meetings we have around the world, are simply how to give these people energy without giving them coal. That's the only issue at like COP21. That was it. Nothing else. How do you give these people energy without giving them coal? And who's going to pay for it? We are, if it's going to happen. So us, Europe, a few other places, either we pay for it or they're going to get coal. That's it. Now, if we look at just the non-fossil fuels, okay, so I want to show here, I mean, these are fossil fuels. Oil's not on here because oil doesn't generally produce a lot of electricity. It produces a transportation fuel, but that's okay. So here, the only two, and I know this is screaming up. I mean, there's no question about that. I mean, it's coming up, no question. But hydro and nuclear are the only ones that ever have made a dent in fossil fuel. And so when people talk about getting rid of hydro and nuclear, it's like, okay, that's something we can think about. So for wind energy, to replace coal will require about 10 million of the big wind turbines, 10 million megawatt wind turbines. And that's going to take 5 billion tons of steel and 10 billion tons of cement. What's the global output of steel? 1.6 billion tons. So now, in order to do this, we're going to have to tell China, stop building buildings, tell people, stop building cars, stop building things that require steel, because we need all of that to build wind turbines. How likely is that? It's not likely, although it can be done. I mean, there's no question about it. So but you could come up with a better mix that doesn't require 10 billion wind turbines, maybe just 5 million wind turbines, 2 million wind turbines. With a combination of hydro, nuclear, wind, and solar, you can do it. You can get rid of coal. But you're not going to do it with one source. It's too much energy. The numbers are too big. And the numbers matter. So they're just too big. We're talking about 30 trillion kilowatt hours. That's a big number. We'll turn it over to Nick.
Whew. Everything's going to be fine. Just kidding. Sorry. That was really good. Before we talk more about nuclear, I know we're well into the talk now, but I wanted to just give you a little context about what exactly is nuclear energy. And one thing I have here, there's this, well, actually, so in the 1895, Wilhelm Röntgen discovers X-rays. He's standing on the shoulders of high voltage technology and new vacuum technology. So he's putting a high voltage across an evacuated thing, and X-rays are coming out. Wow. The world goes into X-ray mania. Everybody starts studying it. And not a year later, this guy who's studying it, named Henri Becquerel, there he is, discovers that there's some kinds of rocks that just randomly shoot out things that look kind of like X-rays, totally spontaneously. And Marie Curie, here on the right, and her husband Pierre studied it in elaborate detail and named it radioactivity. So here I have some rocks that are in the orange dye of my Fiesta wear plate, and they are spontaneously shooting out chunks of atoms known as radioactivity. And I have a Geiger counter, and I can measure it.
That's why they call it Fiesta Ware.
So that's really interesting. And by the way, if the plate wasn't here and I had this over here, you'd still be detecting them at about this rate, because radiation is everywhere. It's coming down from cosmic rays. It's in granite. It's in your marble or your granite countertops. It's hot. This is not a dangerous level of radiation. But anyway, so these guys discovered radiation, and that's really interesting. And it took about 30 years for someone to find out that if you shoot a subatomic particle called a neutron at some atoms similar to these, they won't just shoot off a small chunk of themselves, they'll actually split in half and release a totally astounding amount of energy, and this process is called fission. And I mean, one atom releasing an astounding amount of energy on an atomic scale, maybe no big deal because you're made of like 10 to the 24th atom, so you wouldn't be able to feel it. But it's a double miracle, because when it splits, it actually shoots out a couple extra neutrons. And those neutrons can go on to hit another nearby uranium atom, and that can split in a chain reaction. And now that you have a chain reaction, you can have a sort of macroscopically tremendous amount of energy. And again, the amount of energy that's released from this process is 2 million times more than a typical chemical bond. So there's just an absolutely astounding amount of energy in this kind of thing. Now, that was, it was 1942 when the first human-made chain reaction was created. The first actual chain reaction on Earth was 2 billion years ago in Africa. That's an interesting story. But anyway, so it was made in 1942. We had basically a nuclear reactor. And then we spent more than two years of the largest, most expensive, and most biggest research project basically ever, called the Manhattan Project, to weaponize it. And that the history of nuclear weapons kind of branches off at that point. But if you go back 2 years before the Manhattan Project to that chain reacting nuclear reactor and look at that, that's a machine that you can use to do something useful, like make electricity or move a submarine around. And so let me just dwell a little bit more on how much energy is in this stuff. And this is the key point about nuclear. This is why people are excited about nuclear, is how much energy is in it. So you heard the numbers about how much energy the world's using. Another way to visualize that is if, say, the whole world's, all of its energy came from coal, which it does not, but if it did, and if you've seen these hopper coals of coal, they're gigantic, the world's using 5.5 of those per second. So it's like, you know, every second, that's how many coal, that's how much energy we're using if it was coal. If you were using uranium or other nuclear fuel, it's 1.5 hopper cars per week. So it's, see you next week. The footprint associated with that, I mean, you don't have to have this ridiculous amount of mining and transportation and lines of fuel and pipelines over. You can just use this very small amount of fuel to make a totally astounding amount of energy. And that right there is the key thing that gets me interested and excited about nuclear.
Enriched or?
No, that's natural.
So that's the ore.
Yes, that's out of the ground. It's much better if it's enriched. Good question, though. And then you've probably seen this XKCD comic. This is a classic. So this is just a plot of energy density, which is how much energy is in a kilogram of the raw material. Sugar, coal, fat, gasoline, uranium. And it goes off the chart and he says, log scales are for quitters who can't find enough paper to make their point properly. Again, so this is it was called a fundamental energy source of the universe when it was discovered. It's really an interesting, astounding amount of energy density, and that gives it most of its interesting characteristics. So that's where we'll start, and you'll hear a lot more about this as we go. And how do you make energy from it? You just get that chain reactor going, it makes a bunch of heat, and you simply pass a coolant by it. Maybe it goes into another, this is a steam generator. In this case, we're doing the most exotic thing to make electricity, boiling water. So you boil the water and it goes into this turbine, which is like blowing on a pinwheel, and that's hooked to a shaft that, in this case, is a generator. It could be a, you know, a submarine, and that powers a city. So this is kind of the fundamental way we use nuclear heat in one of those chain reactions that's in a machine called a nuclear reactor. This is how you convert it to like electricity. So that's the basics of sort of what is nuclear energy.
Oh wait, this is yours.
Oh, sorry.
I get my own.
Right.
All right, everyone. So before I do my little piece, I told you that I didn't always start out liking nuclear power. So what do you think of when you hear the word nuclear? Just throw it out there.
Chernobyl.
Chernobyl?
Weapons.
Simpsons.
Simpsons,
thank you. Yeah. What else? That's not it.
Fukushima.
Whoops.
Whoops, yeah. Fukushima, what else?
Our last best hope.
Our last best hope.
Waste.
What was that?
Cost.
France. What was that?
France.
Yeah.
Japan.
What was that?
Japan.
I guess I need to get my ears checked. Japan, yes.
Terrorists.
Efficiency.
Efficiency.
So we have a lot on our minds when we hear the word nuclear, right?
Fusion.
Subs.
Waste,
again, so obviously waste is on a lot of our minds. So I'm not going to talk about all these things. I don't think we could possibly cover all of them, but just recognize that we have all these things in our heads when we hear the word nuclear, and they might color how we listen to others when they're talking about issues related to nuclear energy. And I mean, the cover front page of the newspaper this morning in my hotel, nuclear. But of course, it was not talking about nuclear energy, something to do with Trump again. So all of these, you know, background issues in our society might affect how we're listening tonight. And it definitely affect how I listened. And also my connection with my peer groups and social groups and political affiliations, etc. They all affect how we hear information that's presented to us. So I'd like to invite everyone to hear this in a different way tonight, to keep an open mind, to be skeptical, to ask questions, and lastly, to be kind. I co-founded Mothers for Nuclear last year, and it was hard, and it's been hard, because people are not always kind in this conversation. They can be very angry, they can be very personal, and that's difficult, but I think in the end, we all care about the same things. Most of us care about the same things, about the prosperity of people and of the planet. So with that, thank you, Jim and Nick, for framing this up. I'm gonna skim through a few of these, and this is the reason why I started Mothers for Nuclear, because I care about humanitarian and environmental problems. And we talked about a growing global population with many living in poverty, air pollution, and climate change. And what are we gonna do about these things? So world population, around 7 billion people right now, is projected to go around 10 or 11 billion in the not so distant future. Where is it going to grow? If you think Seattle traffic is bad now, we're not even like a blip. We're the USA and Canada is the blue on this graph here. So take that in perspective for a moment and realize that it's not about us, it's about the entire globe. And especially Africa and India are exploding in population. These same areas of the world, most people are living in extreme poverty. Extreme poverty is defined as an income of less than $1.90 per day. And it's something that we don't have to deal with a lot here because we have energy. Look at our energy usage. It's dark blue, anyway. And the areas that are in extreme poverty also use very little energy. If we are humanitarians at all, we should want them to use more energy, and so they can get a higher quality of life. Global energy use is predominantly fossil. That's purple on this graph. And you can see other renewables have come onto the scene relatively recently, but they've not displaced the fossil. And here in the United States, where we are a developed country and talking loud about climate change, we are still using mostly fossil coal and natural gas, purple and red on this graph. So, and by the way, like I said, I am a civil engineer. I care about these topics, but I am taking all of the compelling information that I've read from other people and presenting it to you here tonight. So I've credited everyone on the slides, but you can go and do your own research afterwards if you want to fact check me. So electricity from clean energy sources has grown in absolute terms. You can see the yellow and the orange on the chart at the top. Wind and solar are coming on the scene, along with hydro and nuclear, which are our largest clean energy sources. However, if you look at it as a percent of total energy, it's not keeping pace. So fossil is making up the difference. And what does that cause? Air pollution that's affecting human health. In 2013, the World Health Organization named air pollution as a leading carcinogen. That's outdoor and indoor air pollution, killing over 6.5 million people per year. Now think about that for a minute. When we think about what is killing people, do we really think about air pollution? It's not just Pittsburgh in 1940. We think that's like a thing of the past, and we've come beyond that, or the killer fogs in London. But look at Delhi, 2016. I just took a screenshot from the internet a couple weeks before putting this slide presentation together. This is happening right now, and it is killing people. It's not just this outdoor air pollution, it's also those areas that are in extreme energy poverty. They're burning wood and dung to cook their food, to heat, and that's inside their homes, and they're breathing that air, and they are dying. They are living extremely shortened lives, and they're subject to serious illness and disease. And then there's climate change. 97% of climate scientists, including one sitting next to me, agree that humans have something to do with this. So the solution is obvious. We need to provide clean and reliable power, but the actual how-tos of that, not quite as obvious. And what we find when we look at the different possible solutions is something that John Muir said. When we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it hitched to everything else in the universe. There's a trade-off with all the choices that we make. So it's not about any one issue, it's about balancing all of them. Also, the solution that we pick, or solutions that we pick, have to be technically feasible. It has to be possible. I've been doing some reading lately on climate science and why people want to deny that humans have anything to do with our changing climate. And some research is saying that it's because they think when you present something that has catastrophic consequences and you say all you have to do is change everything about your life and then it'll be okay. All you have to do is change everything about your modern society and then we can fix this. People don't want to believe that it's true. And so we need to present solutions that are technically possible and that we can do with some urgency. This is my daughter, Kate. The balancing act. Here are a few of the issues that we need to balance. Carbon emissions, particulate emissions, land footprint, waste, raw materials, wildlife, impact on wildlife, safety, and cost. And I'd love to talk a lot more about each of these in particular, but I'm not going to. Nuclear is very low life cycle carbon. It's not just about the carbon that an energy source emits while you're making electricity. It's about everything it took to build it as well. And you can tell coal, natural gas, very high. But biomass, look, very high carbon emissions, but at least in California, it's called renewable, so it's part of our renewable portfolio standard, and we're encouraged to build more of it. Yeah, nuclear is even lower life cycle carbon emission than solar, interesting enough. Land footprint. So here's Ivanpah Solar Thermal Generating Station. And it's kind of hard to see, but there's three fields, and there's a tower in the middle. There you go. And it's focused, the mirrors are focusing light, heating a process fluid, making electricity. It would take 27 of these to equal Diablo Canyon's power. This is Diablo Canyon on the central coast of California. It's really hard to see the plant footprint because it's so tiny at this distance away. But that's the whole point, is that it's not using very much land. And all the land around it is preserved and not trampled by people or industries, it's protected. Also the tide pools and coastlines around it, completely protected. So that's one reason why I changed my mind about nuclear, because I saw how we were able to preserve land and natural spaces.
Are those letters the same scale?
They are the same scale. But I tried to do one with 27 Ivanpahs next to Diablo Canyon, and the scale got too ridiculous. So you just have to imagine 27 of these. Also, there's the challenge of intermittency. So I've heard a lot of people talk about wanting to go completely solar and wind with maybe some hydro, depends on which environmental group you talk to. But there's a challenge in intermittency, and the challenge now is that the nameplate capacity of an energy source does not matter if it's not available, if you can't call on it when you need it, because we need a reliable grid, we need reliable electricity. Power outages are very expensive and they kill people. And to operate our modern society, we need to have reliable power. And so if you have, this is a output from a solar plant, and you can see the dips even during the day. So that's, if you were only relying on this, you would be losing a bunch of customers every time that power dipped. So you need to have backup needed for these intermittent unavailable sources. And we don't do energy storage very well. In the United States total, we have something on the order of minutes worth of energy storage, not hours, not days, not weeks, like we do with other commodities. So in absence, we're backing up intermittent sources with fossil, because it's the only thing we can do. And here's a real life example of that. At the bottom is France, carbon intensity of French electricity, and at the top, carbon intensity of German electricity. France decarbonized in the 70s before it was even a thing. They wanted to reduce their reliance on foreign oil, so they built nuclear. They're 75% nuclear now. Germany is getting out of nuclear, and they're going green. Not very green if you ask the climate, because they are 10 times more carbon intensive than Germany still.
How does that compare to the U.S.?
What's that?
How does that compare to the U.S.? Share your finger example.
I don't have a graph of the U.S., but yeah, we're like, we're right here.
And is it because in addition to the green, they also have a lot of coal left over from East Germany?
They've just announced they're not getting out of coal because they can't. They're burning coal and lignite, brown coal, which is the dirtiest coal.
Right, but it's not because of the greening, it's because of the coal that's been around for a long time.
But they do need to back up their green sources with coal, which is why they're still building coal.
Coal's a terrible thing to back up with because it's baseload, not dispatchable. You need a dispatchable source to back up renewables, which coal isn't, nor is nuclear.
Can I just jump in there? The new coal plants that Germany's building are actually, you can ramp up and down fairly quickly. Okay, it's not efficient, of course, and they use brown coal, which is, again, the dirtiest coal, but they have a lot of that. And so they're actually increasing coal and natural gas as well at about the same rate they're increasing renewables in order to buffer the renewables. At the same time, they're getting rid of nuclear.
Nuclear energy is threatened around the world, not just in the United States, but around the world, and we could lose quite a bit of nuclear capacity in the relatively near term. And here in the United States, 15 or more nuclear plants are at risk of premature closure. And what we're doing essentially, here's 2015 US solar generated on the right. We're essentially closing down one clean source and saying we're replacing it with another, but at the same time, we're not making a dent on fossil. So something that one of the reasons why we founded Mothers for Nuclear is because we think we should be using all clean sources to replace fossil, not use clean sources to replace one another. And the fossil industry knows that nuclear power will make a dent. So here's a couple of my favorite advertisements. Here's from Australia. Nuclear power will kill the coal industry. Yes, it will. That's the point. Here's from anti-nuclear activism against the Shoreham plant in New Jersey. And the fine print at the bottom is sponsored in the public interest by the Oil Heat Institute. Solar, not nuclear. They know that solar is not going to impact their business, but nuclear will. And I've been trying to get a little bit better at social media recently and find a lot of things on Twitter. I follow some of these energy companies that are heavily invested in natural gas. They love to promote solar and wind because they know they're not impacting their business. And this says natural gas, the perfect partner for renewables. So we definitely need other clean sources to partner with renewables. We can't be satisfied just with natural gas partnering with renewables, because as Jim's slide shows, we have to get to zero carbon emissions, and we're not going to get there if we partner natural gas and coal with renewables. So pro-nuclear environmentalists have been starting to speak up. They have for a little while, but especially recently. This is from a march that we did last summer. And we're partnering around the things that we all care about: human health, health of the environment, climate, etc. We all care about something a little bit different and in a different way, but it's been encouraging to meet these people. And kind of, it was scary when I changed my mind about nuclear, and I felt like I was going to lose all my groups and associations. And it can be scary for many of you to reevaluate your beliefs, but you're not alone, and there are others who are reevaluating all of the options that we have. Thank you very much.
Are we doing questions? You're waiting at the end?
There is a questions section at the end. But yeah, so how much time do we need to leave for that? I have to speed things up a little bit. I'm just going to go fast. Okay, so advanced reactors. So I do advanced reactor design, like I said, over in Bellevue. These are next generation plants that have capabilities that are beyond what the current generation have. Now, so I should mention that.
Fourth.
Talking about fourth generation. There's three out there now, so four. But anyway, you're right. There's like a 3+ in the middle. Anyway, so the vast majority of the reactors that are out there operating right now are descended from the nuclear Navy reactors. They use pressurized water, boiling water reactors. They're very effective sources of energy. As you've seen a little bit already, they're extremely low carbon. You'll see in a minute that they're actually one of the safest sources of energies we know, which surprises some people. When that was said at City Hall a few months ago, I think the room like erupted in laughter, which was pretty interesting to watch. It's actually true. There's actually thousands of different configurations you can make in a reactor to have different fuels, different coolants, and different power conversion cycles. And I just want to briefly touch on some of the potential there as we talk about scaling nuclear up dramatically. So the first advanced reactors were really studied because we thought there was very little uranium in the world. And so when we were building traditional reactors, which only burn like 1% of the fuel that you put in them, we thought, oh geez, we're going to run out of uranium. Turned out, as people went out and looked for more uranium, they found a lot more than was originally estimated. So there wasn't the urgency to go to the advanced reactors. But if we do scale up to substantial, 50% of our energy nuclear or something, we have electric cars coming on, those are going to need an energy source to fuel them. They aren't electricity. You can't just plug it in the wall and say, it's like an emission-free car if it's plugged into a coal plant. If we do substantially electrify our cars, that's a huge electricity demand. So anyway, my vision is kind of to see a very large increase in nuclear, maybe something like 50% with the renewables. So there's another, besides uranium, which may become an issue, but maybe not, there's some other issues. And one of them is summarized in this graph, which I really like. I made it. This shows the reactor power during a shutdown. So when you're running a nuclear reactor and you put the control rods in really fast because you want to shut it down, the chain reaction stops. It stops dead. So what's the problem? Well, it turns out that in a nuclear reactor, some of the energy comes out later. So when you put those rods in, the rods that are still in there still have some heat in it. It's called decay heat. And it releases itself exponentially over time. And it starts at about 7%. And 7% of a billion watts is, 70 million watts. So it's a lot. So you have to cool this heat to keep your reactor safe. And so reactors have a bunch of cooling systems, backup power, diesel generators, whatever, to keep that stuff cool for a while until it gets down to a point that it can kind of handle itself. And so traditional reactors have active systems to do this. Well, There are reactors out there that use different types of coolants and configurations that do not need active systems. They can use passive systems, or natural safety, as we call it, where they can just naturally circulate and dump that heat to atmosphere with no power, no human intervention, or anything. And this isn't a fantasy. This is the EBR-2 reactor, which the shell of which is still sitting outside Idaho Falls in Idaho. And this is a, EBR-2 means experimental breeder reactor. And this was a liquid sodium cooled reactor that had unbelievable safety characteristics. And in 1986, they did this safety demo where they invited all these people over. They were so confident in it. My thesis advisor was actually there. And they said, all right, guys, watch this. We're going to just have this reactor at full power. We're going to shut down the primary pump, which would just be catastrophic to many plants. And without inserting the control rods. The control rods are not going to actuate. And everyone said, oh, that's crazy. But so they did it, and they shut the pump down in the reactor. The temperature went up a little bit, and then the laws of physics brought the temperature down, and it went into natural circulation. It shut down power levels, and it would have been where it would have stayed indefinitely. This reactor was unbelievably safe, even in totally kind of unimaginable scenarios where you lose power for 40 years in the area or something. They did another test very similar to it a few days later. And so the people who worked there, you talk to these guys, you know, I've met a few of them, and it's just kind of, they're like, we had this energy source. It was perfect. It was super safe. It could have lasted the humanity at world scale for tens of thousands of years. And it was totally clean air, no problem. It recycled its own waste. It was incredible, like problem solved. Yet here we are, you know, 30 years later thinking, boy, I wish we had a great energy source. And one of the sort of horrible ironies, not a month after those safety tests happened, Chernobyl happened. And you've all heard of Chernobyl, but I bet not too many of you have heard of EBR-2. It's kind of a sad chapter in advanced reactor history. But anyway, so now there's actually quite a bit of interest in advanced nuclear around the world. Lots of countries have advanced nuclear programs. France has a large one. Korea is working on a great reactor. This is a picture of one under construction in India, the big silver one. There are a bunch of startup companies in the United States right now, I think started by this guy, Bill Gates. This is a picture of an MOU being signed with TerraPower. So we're working on an advanced reactor that is totally based on the EBR-2 technology, but has another twist on it. The EBR-2 needed chemical reprocessing, which is good, but could also end up being pretty expensive. So TerraPower said, well, what if we just don't use reprocessing and we still get most of the benefits from that and we have to use high burnup or advanced fuel? So that's what we're working on. It's basically EBR-2, but with a twist. And that's a pretty exciting venture that I'm involved in. There's also, you may have heard of pebble bed reactors. These have like gas coolant that just flows through these beds of pebbles. This thing has a similar capability. It can shut down and all the heat from these things. It can go up to super high temperatures and can just conduct its heat out with no problem. And there's no way to release radiation in like any scenario with this kind of reactor. Super interesting. You've heard of thorium? How many people have heard of thorium on the internet? Oh, wow. I'm amazed. So like 10 years ago, nobody heard of thorium. There's this guy, Kirk Sorensen, who taught everyone about thorium on the internet. It's really interesting. So thorium is an alternate nuclear fuel like uranium. It can be used in reactors that have liquid fuel instead of solid fuel, and that gives you a bunch of pretty interesting advantages. If something heats up, it can sort of spill into a big passively cool decay tank. So it's also something that's thought to be really safe. And we operated one of these in the 60s very successfully down in Tennessee. So, and there's a bunch of companies that are looking at this, including Transatomic with Leslie Dewan and a bunch of several other companies in the US, plus some very big efforts that are actually going on in China with like 400 people working on it. So there's some pretty serious efforts going into advanced reactors. So anyway, I just wanted to give you a brief overview of some of the advanced reactor stuff going on. Hopefully, if you have a question, we'll do it in the Q&A. That's all I have for now. Thanks.
Okay, so we'll talk a little bit about radiation and safety. From my point of view, coming at this from another part of the energy industry, and in any nuclear background. This was the thing that worried me the most. It really is at the basis for a great deal of our worries about nuclear power, the fear of radiation. And what I found in a lot of my reading really surprised me a great deal, and I want to share some of it with you. It surprised me so much that I didn't want to talk about it with my friends or with others. But you, you're special people. You know, my family knows a lot about this. But so does the entire radiological community. I'll read to you, actually I'll recite it to you because I've memorized it, what a director of the CDC radiological program told me at the end of this presentation. But I wanna approach this in somewhat of an unconventional way, I guess. We do the first. So just a set of numbers, the top three numbers, 300, 50, and 50. 300 reactors, that's the average number of reactors that have been working full time since really the beginning of nuclear power outside of the United States. That's about 50 years. So 300 reactors working not 24/7 all the time, but 24/7 for the majority of their lifetimes. Okay, over 50 years, and 50 is the number of people who have died in nuclear accidents over that period of time. Okay? Now, I worked in the oil industry. There are thousands of deaths every year. Every single year. It is a very dangerous industry to drill and produce oil and natural gas. There are also deaths in the wind industry. Wind turbines blow down, they hit houses. That's been taken care of a fair bit, but not entirely. I should mention hydro, but we'll talk about that in a little while. But then I have another set of numbers for you because that's specific to the United States. Okay, we've been producing about an average of 60 reactors. We have 99. We had up to 107 at one point. For 60 years, sorry, we've had 70 reactors for 60 years. That's the average. And we have had not a single death. Not one. And I'm talking about the public. Not a single death. Not one. I'm not going to have you repeat it. I'm emphasizing it because these are very simple numbers. And I would maintain that we are afraid of spirits and demons and not reality. These are simple, factual numbers. So you've seen a number of these pictures, right? This is in Delhi. Delhi is now the head place for air pollution in the world. It took over from Beijing and a few other cities, Linfen in North China recently. This is the site of many, many children going to school every day. And you can find a fair number of images of children with scarves over their face and more. This is what we're talking about. China's a kind of a mature society at this point. The one-child policy has had its impact over 35 years. India has a huge young population. So does Indonesia. And this is what they're facing. So this is not just for people who are mature, but for young, very young children. Okay. This is an iconic image, is it not? How many people have seen this image before? So this is Chernobyl, taken in 1989. So I shouldn't have to say too much about this. Has anyone been there, by the way? Yeah, they've been there. How could they be there? Because they lead tour groups there. They don't let you sleep overnight. They don't let you stay around too long. There are places they don't want you to go near, but there are tour groups there in Ukraine. Okay, so we've had 30 years. What are the findings of the impact on human health? I'm just going to focus on that and just another few set of numbers for you to see, and then one short paragraph of text that the Chernobyl Forum, consisting of those eight different UN organizations, put together. So I upped the number of deaths to 56. Why did I do that? Because there were over 170 young men who were sent in to put out the fires, who received pretty high levels of radiation. And the chances are, in terms of models, a probability of forecast, that they will come down with serious cancer and probably die from it. So far, the numbers are much closer to 40. That includes workers who went in early, workers who were not told about the radiation, who were given no extra protection, even though the operators were able to drink some fluid that had iodine in it. Very interesting. None of that was distributed to the firemen and the policemen and the soldiers that went in. And even more important, none of it was distributed to the people who lived in the region. So about 36 of the 31 of the firemen and the policemen who went in died of radiation poisoning. And there's a wonderful Nobel Prize winning book called Voices from Chernobyl by a Ukrainian writer, Alexievich, her name is. It's quite something. I quote her in the book that Brian mentioned. And then there were 9 children who died from thyroid cancer. They were not told by the authorities who knew, don't drink the milk from your own cows, because the fallout nearby was enough, had enough iodine that would last for only a couple of months because it has a half-life of only 8 days. Don't drink the milk. Wait a couple of months. Drink bottled water, drink milk that's sold from elsewhere. This was the Soviet Union. Chernobyl, some of you may know this and some of you may not, was based on a reactor that never would have been built in the West. Hanford was not a nuclear reactor for power. It was for making weapons.
But there's nothing in Hanford that was like Chernobyl. There's no RBKM reactors.
No, it's not a channel type reactor. In any case, no one was told, no one was given any warning, and then there was a panic evacuation. Okay, now in terms of the models that are used by radiologists today to estimate how many excess cancers there would be, this is the result. And this is for all of Europe, okay, because there was a large degree of scattering of low levels of radiation. In fact, Chernobyl was discovered in Sweden. You know this? Yeah, was discovered in Sweden in terms of the radiation that they were finding in the air and on reindeer. But the models predict that there'd be 22,800, about 23,000 cancers for 570 million people. That's 23,000 in excess of the 194 million cancers that are expected, because the cancer rate is close to 30%. Normally, radiation or no radiation. But it's the conclusion here that I want to draw your attention to the most. The most significant problems have become the severe social and economic depression of the affected regions, persistent myths and misperceptions about the threat of radiation have resulted in, quote, paralyzing fatalism among residents of the affected areas. Any nuclear groups will tell you that this is bunk. I have been told this to my face many times. This is not bunk, and the same thing is happening in Fukushima. The fear of radiation causes more damage than the radiation could ever achieve at the levels that were produced. People attribute everything that happens to them as a reflection of the radiation doses that they've absorbed. It's a very, very complex situation. But to try and deny the trauma of the event does a terrible disservice to everybody, but especially to the people who suffered from that. By the way, if you go to Chernobyl, you might find that it's the largest wildlife preserve in all of Eurasia. The animals have come back in force. In fact, those horses in the upper left, that's Przewalski's horse. That went extinct in the wild, and now it's being brought back in the wild in the Chernobyl exclusion zone, the zone where you have to have a special permit with a tour guide to go to. The gentleman down there holding the owl was extinct in the Chernobyl area in this particular portion of Ukraine. Now it is back in force. This is very interesting. These are mammals, right?
No.
No, okay.
The owl's not an owl.
The owl's, he's right, he's right. Next slide, please, hurry. Okay, nice place to take a vacation in Kerala, India. Okay, the sands of the beaches at Kerala are full of thorium. They're full of the mineral called monazite. They're washed down through the rivers and spread by longshore drift in the Kerala coast. This is called the Malabar coast. It used to be a place for pirates. Very famous. This has one of the highest natural background radiation levels, full body doses anywhere in the world. Ah, and you're wondering, what about cancer rates? Well, yeah, they've been studied, and actually they are even a little bit lower than they are in the rest of India, not higher. Should you take a visit there? I would suggest you might. Come home with a nice bag of thorium-rich sand, because this is what India sees as its future, part of its nuclear future, mining the thorium sand and using that for fuel. This is serious, by the way. Next slide, please. Now, Kerala cannot compare to Ramsar. Ramsar has three times the level of radiation that Kerala has. But it is a summer haunt for people from Tehran, where the summer gets very hot in Tehran. They come to the northern coast, which is on the border of the Caspian Sea. You get nice breezes coming down that way, quite cool. A lot of mists in the mountains. These are the Elbrus Mountains, Thrust Mountains, by the way. But there are also hot springs, and these hot springs overflow, produce a rock called travertine. When the water evaporates out, the mineral salts are left behind, and the president's palace, or the local Baron's Palace in ages past were built out of that. That is full of uranium and thorium. And these springs have among the highest radiation levels anywhere on Earth. Cancer rates, I'm afraid they're just not that high. They just have not gone up. And there's no increase in death here. This is a place that has 50,000 people normally, and swells to over 200,000 during the summer. People have cottages here, they have cabins, they have houses, and they take baths in radium springs. You've heard of radium springs before, right? Yeah. Well, this is the most radioactive radium spring on Earth. Okay, so let's do some comparisons. Now, I'm not gonna tell you what these units mean. We're just gonna use numbers, bare numbers. They are actual units. And they are standard units, SI units. We're just going to look at them. Natural background radiation is about 2.4 to 3 in the United States. 2.4 is the world average. Okay? Next one. Finland and Scandinavia as a whole, which have a lot of granite, granite has a lot of uranium in it compared to other rocks, they get up to around 35, even 40 in places. That's pretty high, or is it? Kerala, India verges on 100. It varies from about 25 up to about 80 normally, but gets up to around 100, so quite a bit more, a lot more certainly than we have here in the United States. And as for Ramsar, they get over 250 at the highest level. Now, this is really high-level radiation if you are a radiologist in the United States. Why? Because our limits, dose limits, are two orders of magnitude less than that. Now, I'm a geoscientist, and this stuff really shocked me. I look at empirical information. Models are great, but they have to be based on empirical data. And if they aren't, then there's a problem. And of course, I want to see what's in the world, what is really out there. Can you hold that till? Okay, next. This is the level of average public exposure in Chernobyl. Somewhere between about 10 and 12, this number. Okay, in Fukushima, it's a little bit less, 10 of this same unit. This is what the Japanese government decided was the level that needed to be achieved before the people could go home. Now think about that. If those people, if some of the people who were evacuated came to the United States and went to Denver, which has a lot of granite in the soil there, that would be 5 times to 10 times the level that they would be allowed to go home if they went back to Japan. Was that a panic response? Not a chance. Of course it was. A panic response to try and re-establish confidence. And of course it did exactly the opposite. Now, just to give one more example, this is what you get with a CAT scan. One CAT scan. How many people here have had CAT scans? I'm sorry, you can't go to Japan, so just cancel your ticket, forget about it. This is what we're dealing with. This is what I found. And seeing this, you're going to say something's wrong. If the limits are so low, something is wrong. And the more you begin to read about this, the more you find that the radiological community realizes that there's something very wrong as well. But their job is to make us all safe. And their rationale is that the lower the level of exposure, the safer we are. An enormous debate is going on in the radiological community about what is called low-level radiation today. The limits are very low, less than 10 in terms of going to a federal facility. And this is a year. We're talking about exposure per year. A very large debate is going on. Next. Okay. Now, this seems to be a joke, right? Two California women on the beach.
Hey.
They haven't been to Diablo Canyon yet, though. Okay. Tanning salon, that is ionizing radiation. Okay, CT scan, we just talked about that. Granite counters, absolutely. They would go off just like the Fiesta wear that we saw before. Okay, this is a joke, yes, but no. Because there was terror on the West Coast from Fukushima. And there was a lot of nasty bullshit on the internet. Excuse me, excuse my French. A lot of nasty stuff on the internet about waves of radiation and plumes coming across, and everybody in California gonna get drenched. And there was great worry about the fish. Could we eat the tuna, the bluefin tuna that we love in sushi? And there was science that was done on all this, and it was all proven to be apocryphal.
You have to eat 300,000 kilograms of tuna to get the average annual dose.
So you're anybody eat that much? You're gonna die of mercury before you'll die of the radiation. Okay, next. We'll go a little faster. Okay, so this is one of the largest myths, and this shocked me a lot because I was convinced, having lived in Japan, actually having gotten engaged in Nagasaki, it's true, and having been to Hiroshima, I was convinced, like many other people in my generation, that there were terrible birth defects for the women that were pregnant, that were survivors of those two attacks. But in fact, this long-lived study, the LIFE study, LSS it's called, has determined that birth defects among children of the atom bomb survivors, no statistically significant increase in major birth defects or untoward pregnancies were seen. And they're talking about 76,000 people, not just a dozen or 100. This really shocked me. No birth defects. They matter in terms of the unavailability of data. The U.S. military did not allow data to be collected during that early period of time. But if we looked at the children that were born during that period of time, we also do not find birth defects in the same way. This is a myth. Urban, rural, doesn't matter. Marine, doesn't matter. It's a myth, and I did find this shocking, but I have seen it repeated many times. Now, the last thing I want to show you is this. This reminds us of Chernobyl, doesn't it? It's a natural gas plant in Middletown, Connecticut. Next. Five people died, 30 people were injured. What if this happened to the Columbia Generating Station? The whole world would frickin' know. Excuse me. Any of you know about this? No. Maybe one or two of you that have relatives in Connecticut. If this were a nuclear reactor, everyone would know. Let's choose another example. This is the Canyon Lake disaster. A dam collapsed in Rapid City, North Dakota in 1972. 235 people killed. How many here know about that? Ah, we have a few. And if that had been a nuclear reactor, the difference is quite amazing. Everybody knows TMI. No one died, no one was injured. Not one member of the public, but we know about it. There have been 12 lawsuits who've been brought against that, and every one of them has either lost or been tossed out of court for lack of evidence. The radiation levels were just too low, way, way too low. This is why I talk about demons and ghosts. They haunt our vision of what nuclear power is. Now, you do not have to believe me. I'm trying to inform you, but you are smart and you can find this out for yourselves. I'm not a doctor, but I can read the medical literature, certainly the abstracts. You can study this, and as Kristen said, check me, fact check me. The very last thing I want to is to recite to you what this gentleman, the director at the CDC, said to me. I asked him, I said, what do you do when you talk to people about radiation? They come up and they ask you, they find out what you do. They're going to ask you, what about, should I worry about this? Should I never go near a nuclear power plant? He said, I do my best to get out of the conversation as fast as I can. He said, in my experience, trying to educate people who are very scared is an uphill battle. It will take a very long time. And I just don't always succeed when I do that. By the way, you can't use my name in your book. So that's what I have to show you. Thank you.
So we should go to questions, but hopefully someone will ask about these guys.
Okay, so let's go to questions from you guys. And here are the rules, okay? Questions, not statements, right? So please, questions. And if you start to go on and on and on, then we'll have to take the microphone away. So.
Let me remind everyone we're on Facebook Live, so please hold the microphone close to your mouth. Thank you.
Also, please go ahead with your question.
Let's talk about cost. What we hear is that there are nuclear power plants all around the country that are coming offline because they can't compete with natural gas on the spot market, and that's where many of them have to compete. We also know that the Columbia Generating Station would not be operating today if it did not have a long-term contract with Bonneville, because it's just more expensive power, dollars per kilowatt hour, than many of the other sources that are available to BPA. So could you please talk about that?
That's a good segue. Okay, I got it. Whoops. Where's my cost slides? Oh dear, the costs are after the safety. Let me move fast here. Okay. We'll come back to costs. Okay. When you talk about costs, there's a bunch of ways to talk about costs. You can talk about levelized costs, which supposedly covers everything. So this is what the state legislators look at when they're talking about building a new power plant, whether it's gas replacing the coal-fired power plant that's going to be closing here, or whether you're talking about nuclear. Whatever you're going to invest in as a state, this is what they look at. Okay, this is the levelized cost. It's supposedly the total life cycle cost, and also financing, which is just really weird to talk about because it's nothing to do with reality, but that's okay. So, but this is what the levelized cost of electricity is, and this is from the Northwest Power Council and the Energy Information Administration of DOE. So this is what everyone looks at when they're talking about costs. And yeah, gas is cheap. So gas is absolutely the easiest thing to build. It takes the least amount of cement, least amount of steel. You can throw it up in a year, and everyone loves it. Okay, and that's okay. Gas is great. So coal and nuclear has always been about the same. Hydro is a little bit more expensive. New hydro. And then solar and wind are very expensive, and solar is the most expensive. Okay. Now these are levelized costs, so they're modeled costs. You assume a financing cost, you assume all this kind of stuff. If you look at the actual lifetime production cost, this is what it costs to produce a kilowatt hour of energy over the lifetime. But you have to go out the lifetime, right? So solar cells last about 20, 25 years, wind turbines last 15 to 20 years, nuclear lasts 80 years, coal lasts about 50 years, gas lasts about 40 years. Hydro lasts about 100 years, okay? So we're not going to be shutting down Grand Coulee anytime soon. It could go for a very long time. And so this is what the actual costs are to produce it. Now, it has nothing to do with the price. Okay, I mean, the cost of electricity in Washington State, we are a regulated market. I love regulations. It's a regulated market, so our cost is 8 cents a kilowatt hour. New York has almost the same mix as us, and the cost is 19 cents a kilowatt hour. They're unregulated. During the polar vortex, they were charging 100 cents a kilowatt hour just because they could. So, again, price has nothing to do with cost. You got to get that out of your mind right away. So these are the cost of production. Now, wind and solar, everyone talks about how cheap they are, and they're not. But with the investment tax credit, which is building, and the production tax credit, which is operating, they drop to, hey, wow, suddenly wind is cheap. It's not cheaper, it's just that the bills, the costs have been moved from the ratepayers to the taxpayers. And that's okay, I mean, I'm a socialist, so that's fine. So that's what happened. So all you've done is moved the cost from the ratepayer to the taxpayer. So, again, nuclear is about 4.1. So the Columbia Generating Station is producing electricity at 4.1, 4.2 cents a kilowatt hour. That's incredibly cheap, historically, just amazing. Gas is 4 cents a kilowatt hour over its lifetime. Again, it's easy to throw up so that the investment cost is cheap. Nuclear is relatively expensive to build right away, but then after it's built, it's cheap. So it kind of depends on what scale of time that you're talking about. Hydro is the cheapest, always has been and always will be, once it's built, okay? Very expensive to build. And coal is about what it's always been. So again, these are now cheap because of tax credits, and that's great. And I actually wanted to thank you all for paying for my electricity bill, because I put solar panels on my roof, and you're all paying me 54 cents a kilowatt hour. Kind of disgusting, but I'll take it. And that's the whole point. I mean, Washington State has a really wonderful solar program, by the way, and you should actually do it before it runs out in 2021. But yeah, I get 54 cents a kilowatt hour for my solar panels, whether I use the electricity or not, by the way. Okay, so, and that's kind of weird, okay? But it's cheap. To me, it's cheap because I actually make money off of that throughout the year. Thank you again. So again, is this fair? Is it, you know, whatever? So the costs have nothing to do with the price. You need to kind of understand that. And wind and solar are cheap only because of the tax credit. So whenever the tax credits expire, everyone stops building wind and solar, and then they wait another year until it gets reinstated, and then they start constructing. That's fine. I mean, this is business.
So it's basically a popularity contest.
Well, no, it's just, I mean, whatever the society, you as a society decide what you want, how you're going to pay for it, that's completely different than what it actually costs to do. So if you want to subsidize electricity, that's fine. Electricity is really cheap, by the way. Electricity and food are the cheapest they've ever been in the history of humanity right now. Cheap, cheap, cheap as a percentage of GDP. So I mean, it's actually very important to know that electricity is really cheap. And so, if you're going to make changes, now is actually the time to make them.
Do these costs include the cost of storing the stuff,
or $10,000? Yes, oh yeah. Nuclear is the only one that actually pays for its waste. Coal doesn't have to pay for its waste.
Wind and solar do too.
What? Wind and solar do too?
Also do, because they don't
no.
waste.
Have you ever
sure they do.
Have you ever decommissioned a large solar array? It's very toxic. There's a lot of toxic stuff, but that's okay. No, they don't. They don't. They have to pay for it later. Someone else has to pay for it. And that's fine, because the waste is usually relatively cheap to the power that it's produced. So again, if you're running something for 20, 25 years and you have to dispose of it, you have to factor that cost in, but you have to normalize it over the whole lifespan.
So,
and the waste is actually, yeah.
I think we got that. Someone's arm's going to fall off in the back here. Let's take care of it.
Yeah. Thank you,
Chris. Thank you for the presentation. So when we're talking about these costs and levelized costs, this isn't taking into account the costs of climate change. Here in Washington State, we had an attempted carbon tax, which was an attempt to integrate these long-term costs into the carbon that we're emitting, because we've been emitting it for free, basically, for, you know, since the Industrial Revolution. So how can either a carbon tax or a price on carbon be used in this situation to the benefit of nuclear power?
Another good segue. God, I did not plant these questions. So what he's talking about is something that's called externalities. So the extra costs that don't come at the end of the month in your bill, right? Someone's paying for them, either our grandchildren or polar bears, or someone is paying for this, but it's not the rate payer, okay? So we basically try to capture those costs in two ways. We talk about a carbon footprint, and we talk about a physical footprint, right? So the area of land that it takes to make that, or the amount of CO2 that it's emitted. So when we talk about a carbon tax, let's just look, you know, $15 a ton. That's a low cost. But this is the cost that's increased in terms of the production costs if you have a carbon tax of $15 a ton emitted. So of course, coal and gas are all about fossil fuel, all about carbon, so they get hit a lot, but that's actually not that much. I mean, $1.46 and 90 cents, not much at all. Of course, nuclear and wind have the least carbon footprint, so they're not affected at all. Solar a little bit more, and hydro a little bit because of cement. Cement production produces a huge amount of CO2 emissions during construction, but not afterwards. Okay, so again, this is a life cycle thing.
Yeah, and this tiny thing from nuclear is, again, because of that energy density that I mentioned early on, it just has this unbelievably low footprint.
Right. In fact, most of the CO2 footprint is, again, during construction, like hydro, because cement. Cement gives off a lot of CO2 when you make it. Then there's, so again, you know, CO2 for fossil fuel, not much CO2 for everything else. Then there's the area to produce, and you have to normalize it, so to produce 1 billion kilowatt hours a year, not very much footprint there, a lot of footprint there. Okay, that's fine. But what's not talked about much is, so who's going to pay for this? I mean, who's going to pay for the CO2 emissions? Who's going to pay for the environmental effects, the future will pay for that.
That's for you to
figure out. So, and then the footprint cost, you just need a lot of area, and that's okay too. Then there's the death print, okay? No one ever talks about the death print. And so, for the death, coal unfortunately kills so many people, you gotta push it off to the side because it's just killed so many people. So this is, again, the number of deaths. Each little square is 40 deaths per trillion kilowatt hours produced, okay? And, you know, coal is it. If you have to, again, if you have to have an evil, coal is it. You know, gas kills a few people, not that much. You know, hydro kills a few people during dam collapses. They don't happen often. They never, hardly ever happen in the U.S., but they happen elsewhere. And so when it happens, it's pretty catastrophic. And these three are just, nuclear, wind, and solar are just accidents. Just, you know, people falling off roofs, installing solar, I'm not kidding, installing solar cells, people falling off wind turbines. It's like, come on, rope up. I mean, this is an easy thing to do. And nuclear is also simply accidents. People falling and breaking their necks doesn't happen very often on a nuclear plant because safety is such a big issue. So if you look at the actual numbers, so here's the numbers. These are mortality rate, again, deaths per trillion kilowatt hours produced. Global average, about 100,000 deaths per trillion kilowatt hours. Coal, I mean, China's much higher because they weren't even scrubbing until recently. You know, US is much, much better. We only kill 10,000 people, just the cost of doing business. Oil, natural gas, a little lower. Then down here, again, these are all accidents. There's no toxicity associated with that. Except, I mean, for nuclear, I use the large number that you talked about, the model number for deaths at Chernobyl, and I threw in some for Fukushima too, just to be nice. And so that's still 90. I mean, you're talking about only 90 dead, and that's in the world. Now, I also have U.S. for there for hydro and for nuclear. Why is coal so little in the? Why do we kill so few people in the U.S. with coal, hydro, and compared to the world?
The air.
Ah, you got it. regulation. I love regulation. So, the Clean Air Act is what did that. I mean, the Clean Air Act is the single piece of legislation that has saved the most lives in the history of the world. It's the if you want to look at one piece of legislation, it's the Clean Air Act. That's why. Is FERC. We actually inspect our dams. A lot of places don't. And then nuclear again, NRC, we inspect them. And if there's any problem, we shut them down. They don't do that in most other countries.
Question in the back.
Hi, I just wanted to thank you guys for putting this on. I've been a huge advocate of nuclear ever since my physics 101 class about 6 years ago. So going back to regulation, actually, so it's my understanding, and I could be wrong because a lot of my information has come from two sources, the Energy Reality Project and Physics for Future Presidents, if you've ever read that. But it's my understanding that a lot of the cost of nuclear stems from insurance and regulation, which adds to the building cost of new nuclear plants. Is that the case? And if so, is that something that we can do something about in terms of?
Yes and no. I mean, actually, it's fine. If you look at the production numbers, I mean, 4 cents a kilowatt hour is awesome. I mean, that's great. If you wanted to do a carbon tax or some other way to capture the fact that it doesn't emit much carbon, that would help. We don't do that. Yeah, we only give the tax credits to renewables right now, not to hydro or nuclear. But even that would help. That's great. But it doesn't really need that. I mean, the fact that solar and wind get these subsidies means they can actually sell their electricity at 0 cents, which happens a lot, actually. It's called negative pricing. So when the huge solar arrays in California start producing a bunch because of the PTC, the production tax credit, they can charge zero. And you can't compete with zero. I mean, there's just no way. Okay, so I mean, gas can't compete with zero. I mean, coal can't compete with hydro, can't compete. Nothing can compete with that. And therefore, they make a lot of money even though they don't charge anything. So I don't know how to fix that.
Let me answer your question in another way. So an application for a new type of reactor was just submitted to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. This is from a company in Oregon called NuScale, and they are building what are called small modular reactors. They produce usually around maybe an order of magnitude less than a large-scale reactor like the Columbia Generating Station. This is a new frontier, and there's a lot of hope in it, in the nuclear industry, both in the U.S. and around the world. China's building theirs. Russia has a version of theirs. The South Koreans have a version of theirs. These are small. They're buried in the ground to a certain degree, and they can be stacked so they can be modularly increased to the scale of a large nuclear reactor or kept very small. The idea is that they can be placed anywhere around the world in any climate and be working all the time. So this first application